Welcome. As India celebrated its 70th year of independence, it's report card time. An opportunity for that unpleasant but much required assessment in a week where over 70 children and babies had their lives snuffed out prematurely. We're asking, why is it that the world's fastest growing major economy ranks below much poorer nations like Bangladesh, Nepal, Ghana and even Liberia when it comes to healthcare for its masses? Why does India have one of the highest household out-of-pocket health expenditures in the world, apart from the most or one of the most inequitable health allocations? Is GDP or even per capita GDP truly a measure of well-being? We are asking today, what is killing our children? Is it disease or is it denial of care? Joining us in studio, Dr. K. Sujata Rao, former Union Health Secretary. She's also the author of Do We Care? India's Health System. We have Aishwarya Bhatti, member of the BJP's legal cell, also advocate of the Supreme Court. Dr. Aparna Hegde, a urogynecologist, the founder and managing trustee of Arman, ANGO that works on mother-child health. Dr. N. Prathap Kumar, MD and chairman of the Mediterranean Group of Hospitals from Kollam in Kerala. This is Dr. Anupam Sibal, Group Medical Director at Apollo Hospital, and Dr. Brigadier Satendra Katoch, the Additional Director of Medical Administration at the Sri Ganga Ram Hospital, New Delhi. Well, this week as India celebrated independence and Janmashtami and many of us just went about our lives as usual, there were many homes that were in mourning. Over 70 children, many babies died painful, traumatic deaths in the BRD hospital in Gorakhpur. There are gory stories in the press of unimaginable cruelty. A child with blood oozing out of its nose and the parent being told that it's just kachara or fluid discharge. No parent should have to undergo such trauma of watching their newborn die due to negligence, and parents of over 70 children did that and their lives will never be the same. Ajay Shukla is one such parent. He joins us. He lost his 17-day-old baby girl and he witnessed at least 20 other babies and children losing their lives in the BRD hospital, in the pediatric ward of the BRD hospital. Shukla ji, thank you so much. This can't be easy. You have come here to talk to us. Thank you very much. Shukla ji, we have heard a lot about what the BRD hospital happened. The media has heard something. The government has its own story. You were there. With you, your daughter is not with you now. What happened? You tell me.
23 July, I went to my family, my missus, to the hospital. 25 July, their operation हुआ बेबी के लिए. बच्ची पैदा होते ही उनको बच्ची को आईसीयू में भेज दिया गया. फिर अचानक 5-6 दिन के बाद, क्योंकि आईसीयू के बगल में एक और है, सीएमसी क्या उसको कहा जा रहा है, उसमें हमारी बच्ची शिफ्ट थी, तो 6-7 दिन के बाद पुनः हमारी बच्ची का तबीयत थोड़ा ख़राब हो गया, बुखार हो गया. उसको डॉक्टर साहब आए, देखे और दवा दिए, तो फिर हमारी बच्ची ठीक हो गई 6 तारीख को. पुनः 7 तारीख को तबीयत खराब हुआ हमारी बच्ची का, तो वो डॉक्टर साहब दवा लिख कर गए, लेकिन वहाँ इतनी लापरवाही है, सिस्टर इंजेक्शन और दवा नहीं दी, जिसके वजह से पुनः हमारी बच्ची का तबीयत 2 बजे ख़राब हो गया. और ख़राब होने के बाद उसको ज़्यादा बुखार हो गया और सांस लेने में उसको दिक्कत लगी होने, तो हम लोग फिर आईसीयू में लेकर के गए बच्ची को. आईसीयू में जब सिस्टर गई तो डॉक्टर साहब कहे, भाई हम तो पहले ही दवा लिख रखे थे, ये दवा क्यों नहीं लगाई, लेकिन उस पर कोई एक्शन नहीं लिया गया. हमको यह कहा गया कि आपको बच्ची को सांस लेने में दिक्कत है. 10 तारीख को पुनः शाम को 5:10 पर हमको बुलाया गया फ़ोन करके, और हम गए तो यह कहा गया कि आपकी बच्ची इस बार करके डेथ कर गई, और अपने बच्ची को डेथ सर्टिफिकेट के साथ हमारी बच्ची को वापस कर दिया गया.
तो आपके ऑलराउंड नेग्लिजेंस थी कि नर्स ने भी बात नहीं मानी जो डॉक्टर ने कहा था, मगर ये जो रिपोर्ट्स है कि ऑक्सीजन नहीं थी, शॉर्टेज ऑफ ऑक्सीजन था.
जी, वहाँ आईसीयू के बगल में एक मीटर लगा हुआ है जिस पर ऑक्सीजन की सप्लाई होती है, वो बताता है. तो उसमें हम 8 तारीख को ही हम देखे कि उसमें लो वैक्यूम लिख रहा था, रेड इंडिकेटर जल रहा था, और 10 तारीख को हमारी बच्ची का देहांत हो गया, डेथ हो गया.
अब आप क्या चाहते हो, आप क्या सोचते हो, सरकार से क्या पूछते हो, क्या कहते हो, क्योंकि प्रधानमंत्री ने भी कहा है इंडिपेंडेंस डे के स्पीच में, उन्होंने कहा था कि बिहार फ्लड्स की तरह ऐसे नेचुरल डिजास्टर्स होते हैं.
हम तो यही चाहेंगे कि उन लोगों के साथ जो मेडिकल प्रशासन के साथ सख्त कार्रवाई की जाए कि पुनः ऐसी घटना न हो जिससे अन्य अभिभावकों के बच्चे पुनः मरे न, माताओं का गोद न उजड़े. मैं तो यही चाहूंगा उनके साथ सख्त कार्रवाई की जाए.
ऑलराइट, अश्वर्या, सो he can't answer that question. He's a father in grief. He's mourning. Who is responsible? Who is accountable? Will anybody be held accountable? Yesterday we had a BJP leader in Chhattisgarh who's been arrested because 200 cows died of starvation in his gaushala. Will any action be taken against anyone in this case?
It is a heart-rending story that we just heard. Of course, it is it's an incident of mammoth proportions. There is a PIL that is filed in the High Court. The High Court, I understand, has issued notice to the government. From what he's saying, it is clearly a case of negligence and misfeasance on account of the administration. And if others have, anybody who has tried to cover up the incident, then they would also be culpable to equal amounts. The courts of law have thankfully been standing up to medical negligence cases. Of course, there are now, this is more like a case of systemic negligence of the hospital, but if there is medical negligence by doctors specifically, those cases also are before courts, and I'm sure the
case, I think the court said no need for an SIT.
Let the investigation come out. Maybe if they feel it right now, there's no need, then I'm sure if more comes out, they will.
You say let the investigation come out, but for example, the UP Health Minister, Mr. Singh, before the investigation, he said that it wasn't a shortage of oxygen. Eventually, it was found to be a shortage of oxygen. Then he said that's not the cause for the death, so there was a shortage of oxygen.
We have heard contradicting stories in the media from different quarters. Therefore, it is all the more necessary that a comprehensive investigation is done, not only to assert what is the real cause why this has happened. If he's saying that the oxygen meter was showing in the red and low category just 2 days before his daughter died, so obviously there is a reason. And unfortunately, we are used to a system which is more proactive, more reactive than proactive, like my colleague here we were discussing just before the show. But an investigation will definitely bring out the truth, and then whoever is guilty and culpable for the direct action as well as to cover up must be held liable.
Ashwara, you keep saying an investigation will bring out the truth, but again, the health minister of UP, he said that such deaths occur every year in August.
See, the courts are now seized of this matter. Even ministry will have to answer to the court. Why should the statement of the health minister be taken as gospel truth? I'm sure there will be investigation. Either which ways, it has to come out.
Dr. Bhatti, Harjeet Singh Bhatti is the head of the Resident Doctors Association at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Their association came up with a statement when two doctors were suspended for all the deaths that took place in Gorakhpur. Why did you write this letter?
Because we as an association have seen these things, that most of the times whenever some tragedy happens in a medical system, it always comes on a doctor. They say that the doctor is responsible.
Isn't the doctor responsible? The doctor is the person you go to be treated.
Yeah, he is going to be treated, but with the limited resources. The problem is with the system. He is not provided with the proper infrastructure. He is not provided with the proper resources, and they are underpowered. There is a lack of doctors. In that patient's parent is saying that the doctors have not given proper, the nurses have not given the proper care, the proper treatment. But this is the problem with every patient attendants who come to the government setup. That BRD Medical College is a tertiary care hospital. There is no primary care center functioning. They are all lack of infrastructure, lack of manpower. There is no secondary care functioning. Everyone is coming to a tertiary care. When the doctor is so much overburdened, when the nurses, the staff is so much overburdened, they are looking after so many patients, then if they are looking after one patient, obviously there are 100 patients standing side, they are saying that our patient is not taken care of. So these things are coming now.
Okay, you say there are no primary healthcare centers. Many would say because many doctors don't work there. That's why there's so much of a burden on the tertiary healthcare sectors. We'll get to that. But your association letter says that doctors are being blamed for the death of the children and that politicians are hiding their incompetency. What did you mean by that?
By this, I want to say that the taking care of hospitals and managing them is also a responsibility. Their moral responsibility also. They have to take the responsibility. If a hospital which is under the chief minister of their state, he is from the same district, and if something wrong is happening there and he is telling that I have visited that hospital many times,
correct,
and he is the 5-time MP from so long from
correct
that district, and if something happens and he says that only doctor is responsible,
so
this is not acceptable.
You're feeling they're passing the buck and making these two doctors a scapegoat. But would you agree that at least if not medical or clinical negligence, can the doctors be accused of administrative negligence?
Doctor can be. I always give that statement that doctor can be a part of this tragedy, but he is not the only part of this tragedy. This tragedy has many more factors which must come out. This
but
is
Dr.
what I am saying.
Dr. Bhatti, for example, one of the doctors, or Dr. Khan, had a private clinic, right? And when you talk about the ills of government hospitals, many would say this is the first thing you talk about, that all doctors have a private clinic. You know, they're getting a fat salary from the government, you have all the perks of this government job, but you have a private clinic and you're sending all the clients, all your patients from the government hospital to your private clinic later in the day.
So, this is, first thing is, there is no comparison between a private clinic and the death of 60 children, because that is totally an infrastructure lapse, and private clinic is something different. And the second thing I will say, that yes, doctors are getting non-practice allowance, they are getting NPA, so they are not supposed to do a private clinic. But the in the government setup, when they see that there is no facilities provided, most of the doctors in state government, state medical colleges, not at Delhi. If you say the state medical colleges or the remote medical colleges, there are some doctors who are practicing, which is not right, but I think they are,
you know. Okay, at least you're admitting it's not right. But as you're pointing out, Gorakhpur is not just a flash in the pan. The harsh truth is that there are several Gorakhpurs waiting to happen. According to the WHO statistics, in 2015, India spends 1.16% of its GDP on health. It ranks 187 amongst 194 countries in terms of expenditure on health. That's 55% of what Indonesia spends, 11% of what Mexico and South Africa spend. China spends 3% of its GDP on healthcare, and the global average is 5.4% of GDP, and the WHO recommends spending 5% of GDP on health. So Jatha Rao, the National Health Policy 2017 talks of increasing the amount of one's GDP one spends on health to 2.5%. In 2025, we've already missed the targets of 2010, which was 2%. Is this an unrealistic, are we setting the target too low, that too in 2025, or is this us being realistic?
I think it is very low if you consider another international estimate, which says that on primary care alone, a country should be spending 5% of GDP. Health is not a cheap proposition. It is a money guzzler, and we do need to spend a lot more than this 1%. So when you say that there's underinvestment, and it's a chronic underinvestment, the disgrace of India is that for 70 years, right, left, center, whatever the government, whatever the political party in power, in any state you find, that they've always neglected health and education. This is unacceptable. And with the result that the whole system has become very dysfunctional. And the development of private sector is really a default position. So now we're talking about public-private partnerships and all that. Whatever partnership, the bottom line is public investment has to increase. There is no getting away from that particular fact. If you come back to the discussion, one of course is that it's unacceptable, that you will agree with me that when there is no oxygen, that the red flag should not have been raised. I mean, there are protocols that are hospital, once it reaches, you know, 1 month before, 10 days, there are red flags. So that situation should never have been there. But states also allow private practice as a way of compensating the salaries, low salaries that they're paying to their own government. So it's not illegal when these doctors are doing private practice. But the idea is that they don't practice during the working hours, they practice off working hours. Okay. But unfortunately, in most of the places, you'll find in, say, in Andhra, you'll find that all these gynecologists or whatever from a teaching medical college would be in their own nursing homes at 11 a.m. So there are these conflicts of interest in this sector which have to be managed with good governance and with good management, and that is not happening. So what has happened in Gorakhpur is a complete management failure, and this is happening not only in government, in private. And so there is an estimate by the Harvard University which says in India, 15% of the 100 who die due to mismanagement of a case, which is a very serious statistic. So I think there is a whole lot of issues of underfunding, poor governance, lack of policy attention, no prioritization. There are a large range of things that have gone wrong. And I think Gorakhpur is really a symptomatic of a much deeper malaise in the fact that the health system is at present suffering from.
Okay, we're hearing a lot of audience applause for doctors specifically. Are many of you medical students?
Is that why you're all invested in this conversation? Okay, let's get your responses. If we have a doctor here saying that, you know, there's so much of a burden that's coming in on the tertiary hospitals, but the fact is there aren't many doctors who are willing to work in primary healthcare centers.
But we're a country where if you order a pizza, it can get delivered to your home. But if you call for an ambulance, that may not happen.
Yes.
Right? And again, the problem is that you hear that the MCI and the government has tried to create some kind of incentives for doctors to go and work in rural areas, because most of the doctors only want to work in big cities. And I can understand why they may want to do that. When that happened, doctors themselves went on protest. Is this not supposed to be a noble profession? Do you not want to serve the poor?
Ma'am, from day one you join a medical school, the first thing that is put into your brains is that this is a noble profession. You need to put your 100% in this. Ma'am, as a professional, if you're working in a particular setup, you definitely expect some reciprocation. The very reason we have brain drain, the very reason we have countries like United States of America getting the maximum supply from India is because neither the private sector nor the government sector in our country reciprocates what a doctor puts in. Number two, as sir said, I would totally agree to it. If anything goes wrong with the patient, the first person to blame is the doctor. Ma'am, a doctor is not a one-man army. You need an entire setup. Ma'am, I'm a medical student, so whatever we are taught, our professors, they definitely tell us that what if you don't have this instrument available, what will you do in such a case? So they all know that there are a lot of loopholes in the system. I don't say that doctors are not at fault, but I totally agree that if the government puts in more funds to the medical setup in our country, definitely things will change.
So, Dr. would you like to respond to that? The fact that the minute somebody dies or something, the doctor is beaten up, which is not right. Because everyone has a role. And when an emergency case comes in, there ought to be protocols like in UK, like in some private hospitals, where what the nurse has to be doing in the first 3 minutes, somebody else has to do in the next 5 minutes. So there are strict accountabilities and responsibilities that are put in. We don't have those accountability
has
framework.
Has the government not done enough to support the students?
We
expect doctors to do everything out of the goodness of their heart. Is the government doing enough? Respond to that question, please.
Well, I don't think we are doing enough, because if we paid them good salaries and gave them the right environment to work, they would go to the primary care health centers. And
okay, what could should we provide them an education at subsidized rates, which are paid for by the Indian taxpayer, and yet at the first chance many doctors just seem to want to run off to the UK or to the US? There was one doctor though who went against the grain. You studied at Stanford.
Yes.
So you could have gotten a job anywhere. You did get a job. You worked at the Cleveland Institute in Florida.
Clinic. Yeah.
So why did you come back?
So I did my residency in Mumbai, you know, and in Mumbai, I have seen these stories play out day in and day out when I did my residency. And that shook me. You know, I have horrific stories that played out every day. And, you know, what bothered me was the reasons mothers and children died when I entered MBBS had not changed. 12 years later, when I did my MBBS, MD, I did my fellowship in laparoscopic surgery before going to US for my, you know, urogynecology fellowship, and I felt responsible. I felt that, you know, we can all blame everybody, we have a victim syndrome, but what can I do? And I felt that as a middle class woman, I feel grateful that I come from a lower middle class family, but I got everything, the education, etc., to get me a good medical school in India. But when I went to Stanford, I needed to study further, but along with that, I also created Arman, which is an NGO which works in the field of mother and child health. So managed Arman through Stanford and Cleveland Clinic. I always knew I was going to come back. And I'm extremely...
But you'd also be making more money there.
I'll tell you one thing about medical college students. All of us come into medical college because we really feel... I wanted to be a scientist, I wanted to do medicine, and I wanted to do research and serve. The primary reason I came into medical college was to serve. Yes, I saw all that I saw, you know, Sion Hospital, I saw all that you're talking about. And at the end of the day, when I, you know, was doing my residency, day in and day out, seeing a lot of apathy, seeing a lot of deaths, at the end of it all, I had a kind of an epiphany where, what am I doing medicine for? Right? Am I going to allow external situations to change the way I approach my medicine? That's when I realized that I wanted to, you know, do a specialization in urogynecology, because it got me into science and, you know, research. But also I wanted to serve and find solutions for the problems I'm receiving. And Arman is my answer to that. And we are already in 7 states. We won the WHO Public Health Champion Award this year.
And we're grateful that you're back. Certainly the people of India are grateful. But doctor, you know, yours is a one-off. It's not the norm. On the other hand, let me play devil's advocate. Many people will complain when you go to a doctor, you just don't get the kind of treatment you want. They're in it. It's a job. They're doing their shifts. They're leaving, especially in government hospitals.
So I think the change has to be dual, both in the system and in the doctors. I'll be honest. You know, honestly. So it has to be dual. Obviously, there has to be regionalization of care. Why are there five babies in a small ICU bed, right? I'm telling you, when I did residency, every day, why talking about such tragedies? You know, it's about, you know, when I used to do emergency duty in Sion Hospital, next day I had to have 40 blood collections, we had 20 bulbs. So even for something like that, we had to run around. I used to, Jugaad is like, we're experts in that. So it is extreme, you know, no matter how good a human being you are, we enter medical college 18-year-olds, right? You're expecting an 18-year-old who really doesn't understand the system, come in, face the most horrific parts of the Indian system and see how it can get, to actually all the time being close to his heart, right? So I think you need to have a dual approach where, yes, Arman was my, answer to that, where I helped to change the system. At the same time, internally also, you try to do your level best.
Dr. Katoch, come in here. It sounds like government hospitals really are a nightmare. They're like everybody wants to avoid it. And studies after studies have shown that in rural areas, 70%, in urban areas, 80% of the public would rather go to a private hospital, even though it is much more expensive.
You see, the care has a huge spectrum. Preventive, promotive, diagnostic, therapeutic. Rehabilitative. Now, putting pressure on secondary care or tertiary care hospitals, whether government or private, going by the numbers that we have, the pressures will always be there. The stress needs to be in primary care. What is predictable is preventable. In a situation like this, the minister said these deaths do happen. Well, they are seasonal deaths, they do happen. And they are predictable, and if they are predictable, something could be preventable. If it's not preventable, something can be done to mitigate that. Vaccinations, for instance, is an answer to that. Going by the numbers, the pressures will always be there, and we will always be working in a scenario of diminishing resources. So stress will always be there, whether government or private.
Okay, so then what is the solution? A public-private partnership is then the option. Dr. Sibal, Mr. Gadkari says that it's not possible to provide professional health care to patients at government health facilities. What would you say in response to this? Because many would say that private hospitals are actually responsible for health care costs just going up out of, you know, the grasp of the average aam aadmi.
Sure. Sir, I'm going to answer your question, but before that, I'm just going to make a couple of comments because there are a lot of young budding doctors here. I think everyone here who's connected with medicine needs to get a sense of pride on what Indian healthcare has achieved. 1947, what was the average life expectancy? Less than 32. What is it today? 69. How many doctors did India have? 50,000. How many do we have? Close to 1 million. How many medical schools did we have? 17. We have more than 450. But of course, the challenges are huge because we produce 25 million kids a year, 25 million babies. So by the time this program ends, 34 children would have died because of dehydration due to diarrhea, acute respiratory infection. More than 440 districts in India do not have a medical college. Three states of India have 33% of all medical colleges, and the states of UP and Bihar that contribute nearly 24 point something percent of the Indian population have 12% of medical colleges. So we need to change the balance. We worry about training, right? So if you look at the number of kids that we get into medical colleges, well, I graduated from Maulana Azad. Maulana Azad today has 250. And LNJP hospital, which is the hospital that is the teaching hospital, has close to 1700 beds. So we can actually train more doctors. Is it easier to build a hospital or is it easier to build a lecture theater? Right? We can build capacity. And if you look at global examples, now look at the postgraduate.
What is the training more doctors if the doctors don't want to work in rural areas?
No, I'll come to 70% that,
Sarah. Of doctors only want to work in urban areas.
Sarah, what is the aspiration of a 23-year-old doctor? See, we are all products of the government system, and we have a lot of regard for the government system because we've gone through the grind. We've actually spent 24 hours awake.
I actually think a 20-year-old doctor is looking for work experience, and he may get that a more satisfying response to his job in rural areas.
Sure.
And I think statistics show that if you're a junior level doctor, you're happy to go work in rural areas.
Absolutely.
It's the specialists and the senior level doctors who are missing.
So there are two reasons why young people are hesitant to go. So one is you need the tools to be able to practice what you've been trained to do. So and that comes, and that, therein comes in what Sujata ji has been saying about money. Now we are so proud of BRICS. What is the average spend on BRICS? It's 7% of GDP. The government spend is about 3.5%. That's the average. We have to put in more money. If we don't put in more money, we're not going to be able to equip the primary centers, the sub-centers, the district hospitals, the medical colleges, so that young people can go and work in the periphery. They want the tools. They've worked really hard. More than 7 lakh students sit for an entrance exam and 58,000 get in. They really work very hard. They've worked day in and day night. Out for 6 years, they want to go and practice medicine. So we have to provide them the tools. The second is, when you're a bit older, when you're 23, 24, you get married. Most doctors get married during training because, you know, you can't really wait till, I mean, I went to 13 years of training. You can't really wait till 30 to get married. So what happens? You have children, right? Can you go and actually put your child in a nursery school, nursery school in a village? So we have to take into account the aspirations of the doctor. And let's be very clear. India is more than 600,000 villages. We are not going to be able to provide 600,000 doctors in villages. Well, how come everything changed with mobile telephony? From land phones to mobile phones, we have more than a billion people with phones. How effectively are we passing on prevention messages to them about breastfeeding, about vaccination, about cleanliness, about smoking, about so many things that we can do? We are not leveraging that. We are not focusing on prevention. We have a huge tsunami there with diabetes, with hypertension, with dyslipidemia, with obesity, with cardiac problems, with cancer.
So you're saying there are many solutions, technology can be used to find solutions. Dr. Kumar, the government, when they say that we should now go in for public-private partnerships, is that an easy way out?
100%, that is the point. Actually, India has a communicable problem and non-communicable diseases. The communicable diseases actually happening even in Kerala. I am from a most literate place of the country, Kerala. We have 96 cath labs for 32 million people, which is more than the US average. That is more than 3 lakhs of population. We have a cath lab which is available in the US for 5 lakhs of population. You go to Bihar and UP, except Patna, nothing is there. If you go to UP, again, Lucknow is the only confined place. All these young, energetic doctors, after passing out of their MBBS, they will never ever ready to work in a rural area. That's the most important challenge of the country. Whatever money is spent by the government, I think if you are ready, you can do that. For that, there are some prospective things to be done. All the people who are becoming a specialist, they will tell that their children should be in one of the biggest school in the available in the country, one of the biggest atmosphere they should grow. Then how we can talk about the poor people of the country, which are actually residing in the rural areas, which is 80% of the population, never get real treatment in the country, because 80% of the treatment is happening in the 20% people surviving metros. So that is why I tell, there was the first PPP model cardiac setup was started by me in ESI hospital in the country. It is in Koilon. We have done 2,800 angioplasty in the last 4 years, saved how many lives? That is one point. In Haryana, there is no cath lab in the government setup in Haryana government. Everything is in the private sector. I represent the private hospital, but we are going to do 50% of the cost of the central government health scheme cost for the poor patients, which will be reimbursed by the government. That is the only way. I will tell you the solution for these things, that tier 1 cities, doctors should be paid less. Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities should be paid double or 4 times the pay, then all these doctors will go to the Tier 2 and 3.
But I think they have put in systems to put in incentives like that, but it still hasn't been working.
It is not an incentive. I am not telling it is incentive. It is incentive to the public. 80% of the people stay in Tier 2 and Tier 3 cities. You are actually looking after these two.
Okay, let's get audience reactions.
I have something to say to sir. You mentioned that we have over 450 medical schools today, which is a great job. We have improved, but our own court records say that one out of every six schools, there have been cases of negligence and they have been called fraudulent by international organizations. So what is the standard that we are setting up as a country?
That's a good question. Sibyl, go ahead, respond to that.
So I think, you know, I'm not aware of the report that you're quoting, but clearly there are provisions in terms of very rigorous inspections that happen, and colleges that default, you know, then are not allowed to take in students. So I think the regulatory mechanism is strong, it's getting stronger, and I'm pretty sure that it will continue to be really, really strong, because it's very important to make sure that the person you give the title of a doctor is really well trained to be able to take on the responsibility that he or she has to shoulder, because the society really looks up to a doctor in being someone who can actually save lives. So it's really important to strengthen that system. But I just want to talk about one interesting aspect that is sometimes ignored when we talk about human resources, and that's about nurses. We do have a huge shortage of nurses, and a lot of things in the United States, in England, are actually taken care of by nurses. And the reason for that is that, again, we produce very few nurses compared to the clinical load that we have. For example, a 500-bedded hospital can only train 100 nurses, though they can train 200 doctors. So I think we really need to look at upping the number of nurses. And I'm saying, just if you did that just for the government nursing schools and colleges by 25%, the number of nurses that we would produce, high quality, would go up considerably.
I will actually object in that point. Basically, the nursing education in our country has a problem. They are actually trained in some small buildings. They never see a patient. And they actually, after training of nursing for 4 years, they come out, they go to a hospital, they work for 6 months, and then I'm a trainee nurse, I'm a trained nurse, I have to get 22,000 rupees, where the politicians will back up them, which actually I'm facing in my place in Kerala. That is actually not to be approved. You should actually, there is two problems in this country. There is no auditing, or medical auditing is not there. Because there is a death happening in every hospital. Why the death happened? And who is the responsible person? Whether a negligence from the doctor or from the system is not analyzed in this country, which is actually analyzed in the US. That is why we tell the American health system is 100% the best system, which is not applicable here. A nursing care, a nurse going to US has to write an exam, and they have to just toll, they have to really struggle hard to get a nursing admission in the US, or a nurse entry into US. Here it is, nurse is very easy. Just go to a building, pay 25,000, after 4 years you get a nurse degree, come to the hospital and treat. I think that is to be changed.
But they're also given more responsibility in the US.
No, it is like responsibility, not only as a nurse, nurse practitioner, nurse anesthetist, nurse coordinator, nurse pharmacist. They can do everything as a doctor.
Right.
But that is only after analyzing they are the best.
So good to get practical reactions to what's happening on the ground. Go ahead, some more reactions.
Supreme Court ne kai sare judgment diye hain ki right to life jo hai aur right to health is right to life also. To isse sarkar ki zimmedari to khatam nahi hogi. Sarkar ko arrange karke dena hai, unko dekhna, wo blaming nahi chalega. Matlab aap, you cannot blame like your predecessors. Main apne bacche ka ek udaharan dena chahta hu. Aapka paida hone se pehle se hi ek jo harassment shuru hota hai maa baap ka, कि आप उसको मतलब आप जांच के लिए भेज रहे होते हैं और अल्ट्रासाउंड वगैरह सब जरूरी है, लेकिन वो सिर्फ खाना पूर्ति हो रही होती है, पूरा सेट है कि आपको पर्चा दे दिया जाएगा, आप इस जांच लैब में चले जाइए, वहां से जाएंगे आप, फिर आप वापस 3 महीने बाद फिर से जाना है, अल्टीमेटली एंड ऑफ द डे कुछ निकलता वगलता कुछ है नहीं उसका. मेरा खुद का बच्चा पैदा हुआ है, जब उसको कंजेनाइटल हार्ट डिजीज से पैदा हुआ, दिल में छेद है आम भाषा में बोले तो, लेकिन और उसके अलावा भी कई सारे कॉम्प्लिकेशंस हैं, और वो सारी चीजें पैदा होने से पहले पता चल जानी चाहिए थी. वो पता नहीं चली, वो बच्चा किसी वजह से, और स्मॉल टाउन में हुआ है ये सब कुछ, और वहां पे वो झेलता रहा उसको, जब तक कि वो शहर में दिल्ली में आता है यहाँ पे, तब तक लेट हो चुका होता है, ऑलमोस्ट 5.5 महीने हो चुके थे. हम बड़े हॉस्पिटल में ले जाते हैं उसको, तो वो उतना टॉप हॉस्पिटल में मैं पहुंच जाता हूँ, जबकि फिर भी वहां पे मुझे वो ऑपरेशन कहते हैं 6 महीने के पहले हो जाना चाहिए तो सक्सेसफुल होता है, अदरवाइज इट इज टू लेट. लाइक तो वो नहीं हो पाया, आज तक मेरे बच्चे का ऑपरेशन नहीं हुआ है, वो वेट कर रहा है, वो परेशान है, अभी भी परेशान है, मैं किसको ब्लेम करूं?
I'm sorry to hear that, but this is a case that you would hear echoed across the country. What happens if you don't live in a big city? For all of us, you get into a car and go straight to a hospital. But what happens if you don't live in one of these big cities that have these big hospitals?
Ma'am,
quick reactions,
I'd like
please.
To talk about the negligence that they are talking that doctors are doing. Ma'am, my seniors who are PG residents now in Safdarjung, they have 48-hour duties, 24-hour duties. How do you expect anyone to do 48 hours of duty? Isn't negligence
That's
inevitable if someone works for 48 hours?
That's a fair point.
मेरा ये मानना है कि priority government की जो है ना वो क्या है वो काफी important होती है. Priority budget layout से लेके कि आप कितने hospitals खोल रहे हैं. Government hospital आप पिछले 10 साल का देखेंगे कि government hospital कितने खुले हैं और private hospital कितने खुले हैं तो आपको फर्क समझ में आ जाएगा government की priority क्या है. और जो ये TSD हुई है गोरखपुर की TSD उसके बाद जो government representatives हैं अगर उनके statement को आप analyze करें उसकी content analysis करें तो आपको पता हो जाएगा कि government की focus और priority क्या है. वो डेसिबल लेवल सड़कों पे हाई होनी चाहिए उसके लिए वो प्रोग्राम बना रहे हैं और ये नहीं कि हमारे पास गवर्नमेंट सर्विसेज बननी चाहिए.
एंड दैट कैन बी सीन इन द फंड्स दैट वी गिव पार्ट ऑफ द जीडीपी दैट गोज टू हेल्थ केयर इट्स रिफ्लेक्ट्स व्हाट द गवर्नमेंट्स प्रायोरिटीज आर व्हेन इट कम्स टू हेल्थ. लास्ट रिएक्शन एंड देन वी टेक क्लोजिंग आर्ग्यूमेंट्स फ्रॉम एवरीबॉडी.
इफ यू हैव अ परमानेंट गवर्नमेंट जॉब एंड इफ यू गेट अ सैलरी ऑब्वियसली डॉक्टर विल बी लेस नेग्लिजेंट बिकॉज ही विल बी द मोस्ट रिस्पॉन्सिबल पर्सन. ही इज द हाइएस्ट पर्सन. पीपल हु आर द सपोर्टिंग स्टाफ दे नो दैट आई एम गोइंग टू गेट सैलरी इन द मंथ एंड then it's not a problem. You know, you can go the way you want to. That is the reason that PPP is the answer, because there the structure is incentive based and the person knows if he doesn't work, he might lose a job. So I think PPP is the answer.
No, that is actually one okay. More thing actually I want to tell about the 24 and 48 hours. Will you see a movie for 24 to 48 hours continuously? Three doctors sitting here. I think we never bothered about working 72 hours in the hospital. Exactly. Actually, I'm a cardiologist. I think if you should enjoy the work. I don't think that is actually the molding of a doctor there. And you should understand that whether I should be penalized, I should be paid for that. I don't think that is the answer for that. No. A doctor should be molded for that.
Okay, I'm going to let one student who, any student wants to respond to doctor?
Yes.
To this?
Anybody, I am a doctor, I am a doctor, I practiced, I am a cardiologist, I worked more than you. So I can answer
okay,
any questions.
One last response and then we're going in for closing argument. Just respond to sir.
Yes.
अगर कोई businessman है, वो आपको कहता है कि मुझे बड़ा आगे मैं क्या करूंगा प्रोग्रेस के लिए, वो कहेगा मुझे अच्छा बिजनेस करना है, पैसे कमाने हैं, तो आप क्या बोलोगे? वेरी गुड, यू आर ऑन योर वे. एक इंजीनियर आपको कहता है कि मैं बड़ा होकर एक अच्छा इंजीनियर बनूंगा, एक अच्छी टेक कंपनी खोलूंगा, पैसे कमाऊंगा, उसे और बढ़ाऊंगा, उसे मल्टीनेशनल कंपनी बनाऊंगा, आप क्या बोलोगे? वेरी ग्रेट. एक डॉक्टर जिसने 5.5 साल में ग्रेजुएशन करी है, उसके बाद वो 3 साल अगर उसका सीधा सिलेक्शन होगा पीजी में तो 3 साल, वरना वो 4-5 कितने भी साल हो सकते हैं, कम से कम उसको 10 साल लग जाएंगे एक डॉक्टर बनने में, देन ही विल गेट अ गुड सैलरी. और अगर वो कहता है कि मुझे एक अच्छी लाइफ चाहिए, अब इतना कुछ मैंने सेक्रीफाइस कर दिया, मुझे एक अच्छी लाइफ चाहिए, मुझे एक गाड़ी भी चाहिए, एक अच्छा घर चाहिए अपने बीवी बच्चों के लिए, अपने माँ बाप के लिए, एवरीबडी नॉन मेडिकल पीपल ईवल.
Now can I answer?
But sir, he's a doctor. There's a doctor.
No,
he
just actually, I'm a doctor. I'm not a businessman. I'm a doctor.
Okay, so
I just wanted to tell you.
I'm going to let you respond. We are out of time. We have to make closing arguments. Yeah. So I'm going to let you start. Make your closing argument by responding to him.
Basically, that is what is actually you should understand that you are actually becoming a doctor. Your thing is you are actually going to make a lot of money for that. That argument should be taken off. Actually, the doctor should have a service mentality. That should be the primary thing, and you make lot of money and you are more paid than any professional in the country by the government as so, a doctor.
Sujata, your closing argument?
My closing arguments are that you know the country has to, the government has to not neglect primary care anymore. That has to be the foundation of a health system. Yeah. And primary care is just not only doing reproductive child health services or universal immunization programs. But it means doing preventive education, it means tobacco control, it means alcohol abuse not to be, to be contained. It means water, sanitation and so on and so forth. There are a whole range of activities that go into primary care or diagnosing infectious diseases, hypertension, diabetes and maintaining the students, the patients. And in India, we are against those set of activities that qualify for primary care. We are right now providing only 15% of them. Mm. That is due to underfunding. That is how badly off the India's health system is. So if we could really provide those 100% of the primary care systems, I tell you there would be at least a 30 to 40%, and this is not my statement, it's a longitudinal study of several countries, US, Brazil, Denmark, UK and so on, which has shown that 30% of reduction in emergency admissions in cardiac cases, in several of these hospital non-communicable diseases were reduced. So that's a huge economic saving too. So Now, when you come to the question is, why aren't doctors going there? The point of primary care, I do think, my second point, that paramedicalization has to be done. And we can't only depend on a doctor because we have a shortage of doctors. I don't really think a doctor needs to be sitting in a primary health care. They can be managed by nurse practitioners. They can be managed by good, well-trained paramedics. And when it comes to doctors, I would like to analyze this whole issue. Yes, we have 450 medical colleges. Most of them are in the private sector. We are producing 54,000 MBBS doctors. But if you break them down, how many fake colleges we have? How many of these doctors who are coming out don't even know how to read a pulse? They don't even know how to use a stethoscope. So we have numbers, but we've been agitating for long to say, please get the MCI reformed. We need to have quality. Quantity is good, but there's no point in producing these fake doctors. And the associated factor with this, with the amount of money that they have to pay, 70 lakhs, 1 crore, 2 crores, how do you expect a guy, unless he's super rich, to be paying 1 crore, he must have sold his assets or taken a loan, to go and work in a primary healthcare setting? It's not possible. He has this pressure. The first pressure that you're putting on a doctor is to recover that money that he has invested on medical education, which is a wrong premise for a poor country like India.
The entire system needs to be changed.
And technology,
doctors will respond. They're saying there's a huge chronic underfunding, and in the midst of all of this, you have private hospitals who continue to push up the cost of healthcare.
No, I think, you know, we are a very young country and we believe in acronyms. So I'm actually going to share an acronym with you on 7 buttons that we need to press. And if we press them right, healthcare will change and the future will be really bright. First is finance. Without money, you really can't do anything. The second is insurance. And we didn't get a chance to talk about it, but we need insurance for everyone. Korea did it. Israel did it. In BRICS, Brazil's done it. We need to have universal insurance for every single Indian. The third is technology, and we really need to use technology, whether it's telemedicine, using the common service centers in the 250,000 villages, just empowering our ashas with iPads so that they're able to converse with a doctor and actually not have to wait, get information right at the click of a button. Assurance, extremely important, and assurance is about the quality of people you produce, doctors, nurses, technicians, physiotherapists, paramedics, pharmacists, but also about the care that you receive. You know, 472 hospitals are accredited by NABH, which has 682 elements that you have to be compliant with to be accredited. So we need our hospitals to be accredited, and we need to link reimbursement to outcomes, to safety, to standardization, to assurance, and that is very, very important. Prevention, and the more we spend on prevention, the better it's going to be for our country. We need to invest in people, and I want to tell all the young people here, in our times, you know, in late 80s and 90s, everybody used to go abroad, but we now got a reversal of brain drain. And why? Because patients from 120 countries come to India for treatment. They respect Indian healthcare. Less than 2,000 doctors. It's cheaper, but it's high quality. It's very high quality, and that's why.
Indians would love to go abroad. All our politicians are going abroad to get treated.
Well,
doctors.
So if we look at this, there's a reversal of brain drain, and that's happening. And less than 2,000 doctors went outside last year. So there's a reversal of that. So we need to invest in people. And very importantly is this public-private partnership, which also has a fourth P, which is people. Because let's face it, 70% of healthcare in India is private. That's not going away. That's not going to change. We have some excellent examples of a PPP in infrastructure, airports. We're all very happy with the PPP model there. There's efficiency. We need to bring in. It's harder in healthcare than it is in infrastructure, but we need to have KPIs.
Dr. Hegde, is that the solution? Private-public partnership? The government seems to say that, okay, they can't provide, they can't do their duty, what's their responsibility, and they're passing the buck on to private-public partnership?
Health needs to be a right. You have to ensure the public health system works. And when you talk about private, it's quacks. 50% of private practice in rural India is quacks. Right? So what are you talking about? And the focus only on doctors. What can doctors do without equipment, enough staffing and facilities? And that is administration. No one is talking about administration here. It's systems and processes. So why does a child die? You know, the three delay model. The first delay is prevention. The community does not know. Right? So technology can be used there. We use mobile Mitra. Right? We send voice calls to pregnant women until the child is 1 year of age. So, you know, you can really prevent emergencies by ensuring the community is aware of what to do during pregnancy and infancy and childhood. Then there is second delay, that is transportation. When there's an emergency, there are no ambulances, there's no nowhere, you don't know where to go. When you go there are no beds available, there are no ICU ventilators available. Gorakhpur, you didn't have ventilators, right? They were handbagging. You know, even though oxygen was not there, remember that even if oxygen was there, there were not enough ventilators. Right? So why did so many kids end up in that BRD college, right? So you have to prevent that. Second is transportation, right place. Third is when they reach there, nothing is there. Like they went to BRD, nothing is there. So you have to look at all of these three delays. Then task shifting is extremely important. You have the ASHA, the Anganwadi worker and the A&M. As long as they are not strengthened, you are not obviously going to ensure that, you know, mothers and children don't die, right? Secondly, adding to what Madam was saying, you have to build a primary health care, but along with primary health care, you should have a good triad system, a referral system. Our referral system does not work. You should be ensuring that mothers and children are getting regular antenatal infancy care at their doorsteps through the primary health centers. Next, the high-risk factors need to be picked up in time, right? So that they're referred in time. Why did his child go into an ICU? Because the perinatal care suffered, right? So you should not have so many children entering the ICU. Why are you being reactive afterwards? So prevent it. So pick up high-risk factors in time. Ensure they can go to the hospital which can provide you that care. So you have to have something called as regionalization of care, it's called. That's a medical terminology for it. Primary health care with triaging, right? Next is, one more thing I want to ask is media. Why did it require a Gorakhpur for you to stand up? You know, honestly, I'm honestly telling you this, when I was building Arman, I used to ask the journalist, why don't you talk about the horrific maternal and childhood situation in India? You know, our infant mortality rate is equal to that of Ethiopia. We're talking of BRIC. Talk about Ethiopia. We are worse than Rwanda. So why are you not making that? You should be having a We the People on maternal child health situation in India every month. You have to be watchdogs. Why are you waking up when Gorakhpur happens? When you have a child dying every 2 minutes, that's an unspeakable tragedy. That should make you wake up.
That, I think that's a good note to end on. Everybody has a responsibility here, including the media, and you're right. We on We the People and at NDTV have been focusing on the issue of health. We'll continue to do so. We're out of time to focus on this issue and other issues that matter to you, that affect you. But we believe it's important to speak your mind, but it's also important to listen. So until next time, bye-bye. Thank you.